Now, Christmas is coming. Oh my God, Christmas is coming.
The geese are getting fat. Please put a penny in the old man.
Okay, we're not going to put a penny in the old man's hat, but you do know, folks, that many, many times the children go up to that pet shop window, look at that furry little fluffy thing running around in the window and say, "Mummy, I want it for Christmas." Now, there's a lot of thought that goes into taking on a pet, and he becomes a member of the family. It's a very, very big responsibility. So to explain more about that and injecting some thought into that decision, we have Chris Pito. Chris, before we start, we need to define who you are, what role you play in the scheme of things.
Right. I come as spokesperson and the new chairman of, or chairperson, to be politically correct, of the Gibraltar Society for the Protection of Against Cruelty to Animals, so in short, the GSPCA. So we represent the sort of needs of the community in respect of the welfare of animals.
Now, there is some confusion there with RSPCA, the Cat Welfare Clinic. There's lots of little branches of.
We were originally the RSPCA, but back in 1998, we lost the Royal Charter because they decided in the UK that they would retain it, and it was very expensive, and the committee at the time thought not to pay to retain that. So they then renamed the charity. We kept our charity number, and we've been sort of plodding along since. And more recently, there's been a change in the way that the committee has been formed, and we've got a new committee, and we are trying to sort of push the charity a bit forward. So I'll take the opportunity to thank those who have been involved thus far, because obviously a lot of good work has gone gone on for a number of years. Well, you know, just to put it out there that we exist, that we are here, and that we want to ensure that animals, in general, are taken care of and that they're not mistreated.
Right, we'll go into that in a second. How big is your committee? How big
well,
is the team?
Well, at the moment, we've got a team of around 8 of us. That includes and something we are liaising with the police at the moment, because there's an animal welfare sort of officer. We liaise directly with the local authorities in order to understand and know what's going on in respect of those animals that are mistreated. Unfortunately, there are certain laws that are in place that prevent animals from being kept for more than 2 weeks. So when they got down to the Gibraltar vet, unfortunately they can't be rehomed. They're euthanized. So we then take them on most occasions. We try and get as many as we can, and we've got a policy of. Attempting to rehome them. We've got a boarding kennel that we use in Spain, unfortunately, where we keep the animals there, and we keep them there, and we've got a policy not to put a good dog down.
Why? No, and you shouldn't. But why don't we have a kennel in Gibraltar?
Fortunately, there isn't any premises, but we've got to thank the government. We are in correspondence with them, and we're looking into it so that we may find alternative accommodation here in Gibraltar, because it's for the animals in Gibraltar, not elsewhere. So.
Is it mostly dogs, or do you get every type of animal?
We've had chickens before.
Goldfish?
I'm sure there has been in the past, but no, we've had chickens, we've had goats, you name it. In terms
chickens
of
some, and goats?
Yes, we have. But luckily enough, those get sort of rehomed very quickly in Spain farms.
Do you find that in a flat in La Laguna? A chicken and a goat?
You'd be surprised.
You are kidding me.
No, and pigs as well.
What?
No.
We didn't take over that case in particular, but the pig was handed to the wildlife park, which we also have dealings. In fact, the head of the wildlife park is part of our committee.
There's a cockerel roundabout where I live. I live by the old town near Governor Street, up at Governor Street, and I hear a cockerel every morning, really, really early. So there must be more animals around there.
Yeah, and for many years I remember walking by the courts, and there used to be a chicken there. So
that's why I remember that.
In the courts garden, just kind of wandering around.
It used to be there. It was a pet. Someone had left it there, and it was happy to stay there. You know, there was feed, there was food, there was there. But that's my recollection.
Well, let's talk a little bit about that. First, let's talk about, because I didn't know, or I mean, you think there is, but maybe not to the extent that you are mentioning, that there is this much of a problem in Gib where there is cruelty towards animal. And what do you define as cruelty towards an animal?
Well, cruelty is any type of abuse which an animal has to endure. That can range from being malnourished to being physically abused. to being sort of kept in very cramped conditions, unhealthy conditions and inhumane conditions, which are not in keeping with the welfare of an animal. So that is what we would define as abuse. Unfortunately, there are a lot of cases in Gibraltar. There are numerous occasions. I wouldn't like to say a lot, but we have seen some very horrific cases where, you know, a dog, for example, was a puppy of only 3 months who had its paws sort of sliced with a Stanley knife and dragged across sort of Main Street or I think it was the upper town area. And the purpose of that by the owner, the then owner, was to try and train it, which is...
Train it to do what?
Well, to try and stop and start.
And what happens to someone like that? And what happens?
Well,
what's the consequence?
In this case, the individual was prosecuted, and I think that he ended up going to prison, which is the right thing, and thankfully... We do have laws for that, and we do. In Gibraltar, we're quite lucky that the police do prosecute.
Well, let's look at the laws for a moment. What kind of process does it take? Let's say I'm at home, I'm living in a block of flats, and I keep hearing this dog whine on the sixth floor, and it's starting to worry me, spending a lot of time locked up. What do I do?
You would have to call the police control room in the first instance. They would then send a police officer to investigate. If they can see that the dog is being kept from the kept in good condition, they will not take any further. Probably leave a note to contact the owner, and then obviously, if you have a committee within your management building or wherever, you can make a complaint, and they can then take it forward. We have had cases where people refer noisy dogs to us. We then investigate. We see whether there is an abuse case. Thankfully, not many then result in sort of us sort of taking a view, but there are cases that, you know, the dogs are left there all day on their own, where they're not taken for walks, they're not being taken.
So that would be come under
neglect,
not being looked after
on
properly.
Social media. A few weeks ago on social media, there was a post of somebody saying that they'd seen a man kicking a dog, and they didn't like, you know, the scene they saw. And I think the police took them up on it, just by reading it on Facebook.
Yeah, the police are very active on Facebook, as we know, and they will take things forward. I mean, a lot of people seem to ignore sort of animal welfare because they seem to think, well, charities in general, you know, I'd rather give it to something that's going to help a child who's in need, or a child who's got cancer, or cancer charities, which is all very good, but we can't forget that there are other needs, and if we're going to, as a community, be responsible, we must ensure that, you know, the animal kind is also taken care of, and that's what we're here for, trying to plug it forward. We are nearing sort of the Christmas period.
Yeah.
People take dogs, they go to a pet shop, buy a dog, and then get fed up, and then in January we get a phone call to pick up the dog, and we've got a perfectly healthy dog in our care because the owners can't take care of it or are not willing to put up with the whining or training of a puppy, which is very sad.
You were going to say?
Yeah, you mentioned a really key thing there, because you said responsible as a community, and I think responsible pet owners is something that I feel quite strongly about. It's nothing I hate more than cruelty to any living animal, human. It's horrible.
Unless it's seagulls. Seagulls
or pigeons.
Pigeons. Or a cockroach.
I think cockroach can be put side apart from, I think, the verb. I mean, I'm not going to make any comments as to seagulls or pigeons because they are animals, albeit they must be controlled, but I will not comment.
I think cruelty to animals says something really disturbing about the person that's cruel to an animal. But more importantly, going back to the thing about responsible society, do we maybe have... We know, with our enthusiasm and our love for pets, have too many in Gibraltar. The reason I said it was that you've got maybe somebody in a little two-bedroom flat with, like, four dogs.
Now, it seems to be the craze to have a pug. I mean, I live on Main Street. I've seen a man kick the hell out of a dog out of my window, and I called the police. This was a long time ago. In fact, I even ran to get my iPad to video it, and it didn't come out, but the police did talk to him. They did. But everybody has a pug. What's going on? There's like a phase.
There's fads, there's puppy mills, you know, puppies are produced en masse. A lot of these puppies are genetically not they've got a lot of genetic problems because they're, you know, mothers and sons or whatever, and they're sold en masse. It's a big problem. So you should really just buy, if you're going to buy dogs, buy from a reputable breeder and ensure that the dog comes with a full bill of health. If you're going to go down the pedigree sort of way. Mm. But there are a lot of animals out there for homing. There's a lot of mataderos in Spain, a lot of animals that are put down weekly, and what we don't want to have is the same situation with our animals that we happen to find here.
Because that seems, again, going back to that responsible community thing, I think it's incredibly irresponsible when people get to animals, I love animals, but actually I'm getting them because I can get £300 a pup. And they're breeding, like you said, puppy mills. And that goes on in Gib. That does go on in Gib for a fact. That surely needs addressed as part of a bigger problem. We need and responsible pet owners then. So they might not be cruel. They may be amazing to their pets, but then they're not particularly responsible to the rest of society.
No.
Dog poo is a huge issue.
I take my dog out for walks and I ensure that I have enough tissue, wipes, doggy bags and...
You water down the wee as well.
And I water down the wee and I've got a spray which I've got the disinfectant and I make sure that wherever my dog's made some mess, it's cleaned up.
But you're not everybody's like you.
But I think it's a responsibility that you've got to have. Not everyone is like me, but... For whatever reason, I'd rather not, because I don't like stepping on dog
mess.
Exactly.
But we're supposed, isn't the police supposed to fine people for
Yes,
for
I mean,
doing
but
it?
how do you find it?
What I would like to know is how many fines have been.
I'm a lawyer by profession. I can tell you that in the last 5 years as a lawyer, I've never actually seen any summons before the court. But I mean, maybe I wasn't there that day. I'm not there every day.
That is the key.
Chris, I wanted to go back to the pet shop because I swore I would never buy an animal. I'd only ever rehome one. But my sons fell in love with this Persian that we've got and they decided to buy it between them anyway. I couldn't say no.
Yeah.
I fell in love with him, my little Aussie. But...
No, my dog is a pet shop dog.
Well,
I bought it in La Línea, but it came in a very bad state. Thankfully,
that's why I was going to ask you. So what guarantees are there that the pets that we're buying from pet shops have pedigrees, have their papers in order, have been well looked after, weaned from their mothers at the right time, etc.?
Most responsible pet shop owners should provide you with a proper certification from a vet that's been checked up and given a clean bill of health and shouldn't have been given the pet to you or an animal within the period that it's still weaning. So the dog is usually around 8 weeks. Cats, I couldn't really tell. That's for the Cat Welfare Society, although we do have some cats in our care as well.
Six, I think it is.
Yeah. But that's the way that it should be done, and that's the way that pet shops should ensure. I mean, I haven't bought a pet here, and I don't know really, so I can't comment how it's done in the pet shop here. Would want to.
It's just interesting to know whether the police regulate that aspect too.
There are provisions within our legislation for investigations to be carried out and there's for investigation officers to be put in place, but there is a police officer that's in charge and they do take in place, but it depends on how much policy it sort of dictates. And again, I think because it doesn't take priority, other things do take priority.
This is a sad thing,
yeah,
isn't it?
It is a sad thing, but anyway. We petition at the highest levels that we can, and we do have a very good rapport with the minister who's in charge of this, Mr. Cortes, which I'd like to thank whilst I'm here for his support over the years and his continued support throughout. He's been very, very helpful to us without a need to, because he doesn't have to. There's so many charities in Gibraltar as well, but he's helped us tremendously. We are in correspondence and we are sort of discussing this as we speak.
Chris, going back to the cruelty aspect, and I mentioned before that it comes in all shapes and forms, there's something you mentioned in the green room to us which I was quite shocked with. Dog fighting?
Yes, dog fighting. That does happen in Gibraltar. There are people, there are instances that we know, we suspect, I'll say suspect. There hasn't been anyone prosecuted just yet. I don't know any of anything and I wouldn't want to comment other than that. But we do know that there are, and we have information given to us, that there are people who are sort of breeding dogs or buying dogs and training them to fight, which is very worrying.
But are they these dangerous dogs, the breeds that,
yes, they are
illegal, aren't they?
Staffordshire mix and the American pit bulls and the ones that are sort of bigger jawed and quite dangerous, they would be defined under the Dangerous Dogs Act as being dangerous dogs.
And then therefore, but how come they have them?
Well, a lot of these dogs, what they do is they mix them with other dogs, and they're not, they're technically what they would be is a mix. So
that's how they get around it.
Yeah. So that's what happens. And there we are.
Where does it go on with them?
What they do is they probably fight them in La Niña. We know that there's an area in La Niña where it happens. And we also know that there has been instances where there's been sort of like sparring up the rock. But we don't have the evidence. We get sort of anonymous calls. We get people emailing us. And we can only go on what they tell us. We cannot do anything other than to present the evidence if we have it. And if we do have it, we do present it to the police. So.
Sorry, you were saying Rouge before.
No, I just wondered. I mean, I've never heard of that going on in Gib. I was quite shocked.
I mean,
to be
we've this is recent. This is in the last year or so. We've had that information come to us, and it was quite shocking.
There's a lot of money in it. No, I mean, I only know from my big fat gypsy wedding. They all dog fight there. All those.
That's true.
Corporal fight. Mojitano.
But there's big money in it because they're all rich. I mean, the wedding dresses that they use.
Surely that must be an easy thing to clamp down on. It's only a matter of localising where
it
is up the rock.
It depends on what's priority, and I'm sure that the investigations have been carried out. If they're not, well, I'm sure that the powers that be are looking at this programme and may take action.
Talking about priority, because it's human nature to only react and act after the occasion. Having those dogs in Gibraltar, is it not only a matter of time before a kid is attacked leaving school? For example,
I mean it's quite plausible. It's something that worries us as well, because you could have an animal who these are animals that are trained to sort of bite and maul another dog towards the throat and neck and sort of cause it to die. A small kid could be walking down Main Street and it could easily be attacked. So it's quite worrying.
But saying that, a friend of mine has I think it's a Staffordshire.
Yes, they're perfectly nice pets if they're trained properly. If you train them to do what they do, they're
family friendly, great with kids, lovely
but
to have around the house.
They're animals at the end of the day. You may have a dog and you may think, oh, this dog, when he looks at me, he's talking to me. I mean, it happens with my pet. Jack Russell is the cutest thing that I've ever seen, but the reality is that it's all animal instinct. It's an animal, and you've got to treat it as such and respect it as well.
I was going to say, and those fighting dogs have been bred for centuries to have an instinct to fight. A friend of mine, when I was a kid, was playing with one of our mutual friends, Staffy dogs, and he had a piece of cake, and he gave half to the dog. And he put the other half in his mouth, and the dog went to get it. And my friend was horrendously disfigured at the age of 12. The dog was destroyed because it represented a danger, but at the end of the day, the dog was just doing what was naturally within its instinct to do. It didn't intend to cause harm. Dangerous dogs are dangerous, you know, and whilst I completely agree with you that, that you know, you shouldn't ever train a dog to fight and so on, there is a certain element of instinct, and so should there be certain breeds that are banned within Gibraltar?
Well, there are certain breeds that are. There is a Dangerous Dogs Act in place, and I mean, I can't name them off the top of my head, but I should have probably printed it. It's not a long act. I've seen it before, but they are illegal, and they will be kept and destroyed. I have actually seen cases of that happening where, you know, in fact, I think I didn't, but a colleague of mine represented an individual very recently on that and fought very, very hard to try and get the dog back home because it was a perfectly happy family dog, but for whatever reason, because it was I think he took it out because it was a mix at the end. It wasn't a pure breed, but I think they do prosecute and they do take dogs. The vet will take dogs on behalf of the police and will euthanize.
In terms of neglect, how far do you have to go for it to be classified as neglect? In other words, I was thinking of maybe having a small dog because I thought, well, you have to take it out maybe once a day is enough because it's tiny. And I've been told that, no, just because it's tiny doesn't mean you've got to take it out.
Not necessarily. You need to give a dog constant exercise, and you've got to ensure that the dog is well-fed, that it's well-watered and taken out occasionally, because I mean, you wouldn't want the dog doing mess all over your house and peeing
everywhere.
Well,
according to Frankie, this dog uses a litter tray.
There's a lot of dogs that have been trained to use litter trays in the house.
I wish I could train mine to do that.
Yeah, there are. A lot of people have trained the dogs.
It would be a little dog.
A chihuahua.
Designer chihuahuas. But a bison, don't have a dog. Have a big dog if you're going to have a dog.
Cat. It looks after
I don't like
itself.
Cats.
You can have a big dog, but if you've got a big house here in Gibraltar, the majority of people live in flats, and you know you can't really
have... But there's loads of people who have dogs.
I know.
They'll walk them after seven when the shops close, everybody's out with their dog.
Up and down Main Street. So I believe, with regards to cruelty, my own personal issue is that the Cruelty Act should include that in Gibraltar it stipulates only small to medium dogs and no large dogs, because I think it's cruel to have a dog in a 60 or 70 square metre flat with a tiny balcony to... Yeah.
Yes, but then you would be legislating and removing people that may have the space. And I'm sure that there's people fortunate enough to have dogs that big, people who live up the rock or whatever.
Chris, in the same way as...
Or yards that will have guard dogs or whatever.
But there are a lot of estates now. New estates where they have their rules about animals.
They ban dogs or any other animals. And if you're going to have dogs, it's usually on the basis that you write in before you even move in.
Exactly, that you've already got one.
Yeah.
So maybe that should be implemented too, and then we reduce the size of dogs. I think it's cruel that they are stuck in apartments in this heat during the day, and they're large
I don't disagree with you on that, but... You know, I'm not a fan of over-legislating for the sake of over-legislating, but that's my lawyer's hat coming on. But then again, because it makes more work for us, and then... But anyway, I'm happy to take on more work. I don't want to sound lazy. I'm not a fan of over-legislation, so it's as and when, I don't think it's required. I think people will be sensible, and the majority of people are sensible. You have the odd people that have an Alsatian in a, you know... four-foot-nothing sort of house, four-square-metre house, whatever, and they'll have the Alsatian in there, and you know, but they'll take care of the dog, so they'll take it out 10 times. So it depends. I mean, I don't really agree with you on that one, but anyway, we'll park that.
Well, we'll agree to disagree. Right, I have a suggestion for you.
Right.
There's a problem at Christmas with these kids pressing their noses up to pet shops. And then, oh, it's all way too much trouble and Daddy has to take him out in the rain and hands him in or deserts them. And there's a problem with you rehousing your dogs.
Yeah. Yeah.
So why don't we have a fostering system whereby families foster animals before they're rehoused and also
get
to trial so that they know whether they can keep them or not?
We do actually do that. We've been doing it now for a couple of years, and some of the dogs that go to these houses are successful, some of them aren't. In fact, now that we're talking about rehoming, we've got 12, the last count. 12 dogs. And we've got one in particular, which is unfortunately the victim of abuse, which now that we're talking about the charity, I'm just going to go out there because I'm going to plug this.
You go ahead.
Where... we had an operation yesterday. It's a dog who has been taken over by an owner. It's a local owner who couldn't pay for the dog's bills. We've had to spend €681, and it's had to have 2 plates and 6 screws in its leg. And that is a big burden on our... Because we get a limited grant, and fundraising. We're very dependent on fundraising, so if people are watching and are willing to donate, please do so. I'll give the details in a short...
It's a coincidence. I've just been asked to ask you about the vet clinic and the GSPCA and donations. Yep. Where to?
Well, at the moment, we are reopening a bank account, so we're waiting for our bank account, and we've applied to the Gibraltar... We're going to be applying to the Gibraltar International Bank. I don't know if the treasurer is organising that. We do have a post office account, and it's 085926. We will put the number on our Facebook page, which is updated almost weekly, and we put videos of the dogs we do have there. So if people want to check up, we are Gibraltar SPCA. There's a few others, but that's the official one. And checks have to be made payable to Gibraltar Savings Bank, and you can send it to our PO box, which is PO box number 778.
Can you just repeat that GSPA? We're just writing it down in the directors.
Right. So our
Gibraltar Facebook page.
Gibraltar SPCA.
Gibraltar SPCA is the Facebook page.
So check it out, and we've got a new logo, which is a nice little dog and a cat, and a nice little squiggle.
And what about the hamsters?
We have hamsters and rabbits as well. We have taken them.
You have hamsters yeah.
and snakes? People here like snakes.
Snakes, yeah, yeah. Usually what happens is that they let them loose up the rock and then you get sort of the animal protection unit, whatever, from the gons.
Chris, let me just look at your PO box.
Yeah, it's 778.
778, folks.
Right?
PO box 778.
Wait, hold on, back to the hamsters. So somebody can't look after a hamster and hands it to you?
No, well, you know, on rabbits, what happens is people... or they can't take care and we will...
See, a lot of people just can't be bothered.
People are very responsible, you'd be surprised. I mean... They can't. I mean, a hamster, you just put the water. I've had all types of pets because we lived in a smaller flat. We got a bigger flat. We got a dog, but I've had even.
I hope your dog's a small one. Oh, it's a
Jack Russell, of course.
You're fine.
I'm responsible. Or are we responsible as a family? So we've had fish, birds, hamsters, mice, turtles, the lot. So quite a small
zoo,
but not all at the same time. Because it's, well, actually, we had the dog and the birds at the same time. Ringo died, unfortunately, but anyway, it was a canary with, he had a bit of a Beatles look.
And you called it Ringo.
Ringo. But he, and actually the dog let us know that he died, but anyway, that's another story. And what was the other question?
Oh, I've just been sent another one. The vet clinic is not the GSPCA.
Yes, that's correct.
Ask him to clarify.
Yes, it's not. The vet clinic is, it's a private business. And he is employed by the government on certain aspects as a Gibraltar government vet in cases where the law requires that to be...
Macacus, for example.
Exactly. Yeah. We are not affiliated with the Gibraltar vet.
Yeah.
Separate from us.
It's a separate entity.
Completely separate from us, but we do work in conjunction with him. So, we don't have a relationship other than that. That's a lot of people are confused. Lo llevo la RSPCA, and they say lo llevo either by Roger Dale, and that's where I left the dog. Of course, and we get people who say, oh, they have a donation. It does or doesn't get to us, or it does. It's for the animals he's got
well,
there.
Well, we've taken down the details and your PO box, etc., etc.
And our email address, if people want to email us on whatever issues that they may have or any clarification, is gspca@mail.com.
Excellent, Chris. Well, thank you very much for joining us. We have to wrap up the programme now. I never thought pets could be so interesting.
Mm.
There you go.
And you've got a cat.
I've got a lovely, lovely cat.
Cold. Cats are cold.
No, he's not. Yes. He gives me cuddles every morning, my Aussie. That's it for tonight, folks.